Hi all, thank you for clicking and joining on this video. Much love and thanks to all of you that have subscribed. If you haven't subscribed, you can go ahead and hit the subscribe button. So in this video, we're going to look at where you've detected an interaction, an underlying antigen interaction, hormone interaction, cytokine interaction in a biological setting, system, experiment, and you want to be able to determine what that response is by using standard curves. And so where you introduce a chromogenic detection system, light absorbance of the visibly colored substrate is used to detect the interaction, and you use something called a spectral photometer. The principle here is that every compound, colored or not, absorbs light characteristically. So they have a specific way that they absorb light. And so by measuring how much light passes through the colored product produced by the enzyme in response to the underlying antigen-antibody interaction, you can analyze the sample or specimen. So you can use this principle to decide if there has been an antibody produced against an antigen, just as a yes or no. Or you can even, if you fine-tune it and put standard, so known amounts of the antigen in there against which you can read your unknown concentration, then you can even decide how much of the antibody-antigen interactions are there in a sample or amongst individuals. In this scenario, you would need a standard curve. You would take a known amount of the antibody or antigen that you're trying to detect. You would do serial dilutions. I have a video up here on how to do serial dilution. It's a critical technique for bioscientists, for anyone working in the laboratory in biological sciences. So take a look at that. So you take a known amount, you do a serial dilution, and the serial dilution allows you to just to incrementally decide how much protein is in each well. That's going to act as something called a standard curve. A standard curve in the sense that it's going to be a reference point for all the samples which you are going to analyze from sources that you don't know how much there is. So the standard curve will be used to reference that, and you read off the standard curve, compare the standard curve with your reading from the unknown patients or samples or experimental group to see how they compare, and from that, you know, estimate how much protein or how much antibody or antigen you have in the unknown samples or specimens. And a spectrophotometer, the absorption of light through that solution, and depending on how much color there is, there'll be different absorption or optical densities as is reported. The detection system, which you can think of as the reporter of the underlying interaction, can also be a fluorescently based detector or a luminescence based detector. It's not always absorbance that you measure in the lab with these kind of assays. And your optical densities is then the Y variable, because it's the response. And then your independent variable is the known concentration. So you put that on the X-axis, and then from that, you'll be able to infer the unknown concentrations. And so you draw a line, and the equation of the line is just turns out to be Y equals MX plus B. But, you know, you can't use a straight line for biological responses, it turns out. It's actually a sigmoidal response in a case where there's sort of the binding is different at different concentrations. So it's not a linear scale. So that's why you can't use a straight line. When you draw the graph, you have the concentrations and then you have their responses. And so if the points are close to a straight line, that's when you can use a linear regression. That's when you can use the equation Y equals MX plus B. And Y equals MX plus B means the response equals or depends on M times X plus B. And M, it turns out, is the slope. So the angle of the line, it's the angle of the line times your concentration, which is X, plus your y-intercept. And your y-intercept is given the symbol B. And your it just means the intercept of the line on Y, which is your response. And so it turns out that unless you're using very limited range of concentrations, you're not really going to have your responses being fitting around a straight line. They're more likely to fit on in a shape that's called the sigmoidal shape, that S shape for like a dose response. And so that S shape is analyzed in a different way because you don't just have these two constants, the M and B, the slope and the y-intercept being the critical factor. There are other factors, and it turns out there are four. So in the straight line, you just have two constants or two parameters that describe that slope or that y. It's actually y equals, so the y is the response. But when it's the sigmoidal shape, you actually have four constants that describe it. And so that's the 4P or the four parameter logistics. It turns out that the four parameters you need are really just to fit the shape. So when it was linear, you only needed two. You just needed the slope and you needed the intercept of B, which is the y-intercept. So you just needed a slope and the y-intercept when it's a straight line. But when it's sigmoidal, you need to know the minimum signal, the half maximum signal, and then you just have this inflection point where it sort of turns and starts to go up to plateau. And then you also need the maximum. And so those are the four parameters. And that's why you assess these sigmoidal shaped fits with a four parameter fit rather than this a straight line, which is just two parameters. It just captures more accurately so that you can read the unknown values. The minimum signal is the point where there isn't much of a signal. It's very close to your negative control. The maximum signal is the point where even though you have a lot of interactions between your ligand and your antibody or your antigen and your antibody, you just won't be able to detect any more signal. It's saturated. It's the maximum output you're going to get from the system, from the assay that you set up. Then there's your inflection point. Your inflection point is given the alphabet B or the symbol B. It's halfway off your slope, halfway up the slope. And it's called another name. It's called the Hill coefficient. And finally, there's the fourth parameter, which is the concentration where you get half of your maximum signal. So there's the maximum signal where it's saturated. And so halfway of that is your L50. So that's your ligand concentration. When your ligand concentration is at half of its maximal saturation. And so in this video, we're really going to get into how you can go ahead and draw your standard curve, putting a line of best fit, get an equation of the line so that you can interpolate or infer from that plot what the concentrations are in your unknown sample. There is actually an online tool where you don't even have to download it called Arrigo, where you can go ahead and put your concentrations in there, and it will also tell you what your unknown concentrations are without you having access to a four parameter logistic software with a four parameter logistic fit capability. You don't even have to download it. You just simply enter your concentrations for your unknowns, your concentrations for your standard curve, and it's going to be able to allow you to determine what your concentrations of your unknowns are. And it needs it to be side by side. So what I did was just to copy it, and then I used the paste transpose to have it side by side. So for standard two, for instance, I just go ahead and copy that. And then if I come here to paste, I right click. And this is the transpose option. So it places it side by side rather than on top of each other as it appears here. And that's the right format for placing it into the data gain ELISA software that we're going to use. So in the gain data Arrigo's ELISA calculator, you're going to go ahead and place the raw optical densities that we've obtained for the standards here, and then it will show us where it's fitting inside the well. So as you can see, it's placed it correctly. We've got our standards right here. We will get to assign which ones are standards over here. You then assign which ones are the unknowns, and in each of these circumstances you can indicate the replicates that you have. So you did, if you did them in duplicates, then you can change it. If you did it in triplicates or quadruplicates, you can also let the software you can also adjust it on this part of the Erigo data interface. And so you go ahead, and once you've entered your experiment name, you select the regression model you want to use. So whether you want to use a 4-parameter logistics, 5-parameter logistics, or a linear regression model. For analyzer data, you definitely use a 4-parameter logistics. If it was just a protein determination, you would select a linear concentration because you've got set responses that you are going to obtain. For normalization, you can either say you don't want it normalized at all, or you want to set the maximum response as 100%, or maybe you want to set the maximum response as 100% and then the minimum as 0%, and then we'll try and fit all the values within that so everything is normalized against your maximum concentration response and your minimum concentration response. So that's the idea of normalization. This, in order for Erigo, for the software to give you a line of best fit, I had to go ahead and subtract the minimum in the other settings. You can't leave it blank. I needed to subtract the minimum from all other optical densities, and the minimum was my zero reading. So we went ahead and ticked that. And you also need to go ahead and set the blank as standard data so that within that fitting of the curve, the software knows what a zero point looks like or where the zero point is. And so once you've got both selected in the other settings, you can go ahead and fill in the other parameters. And then in terms of your plot settings, the scale that you want to use, you can use normal scale, or you can maybe perhaps you want to use a semi-log, or you want to use a log-log scale. Then you go ahead and hit analyze. And in analyze, what you see is that it's going, because it's a 4-parameter logistics, it's going to apply 4 parameters in determining the equation of the line, where your A equates to the theoretical response you would have received at zero concentration. So the concentration where you did not have any of the hormone present. Then B is the slope of the curve. C is called the inflection point, this may equate to your effective concentration 50 or your inhibitory concentration 50, and D is your theoretical response at infinite concentration. And here we go. Now I have a fit, a line of best fit for this. We're using the 4-parameter logistics. So you can see that was the equation, and it's gone ahead and computed the values. It's telling me my line of best fit is 1. It's perfect fit. As you can see, it's really going through all the points, all the values. And so based on that, it's been able to spit out an unknown value for me. So I'm able to obtain concentrations now based on this standard curve, which was based, if you remember, on the concentrations that I have told it to calculate. And that's how easy it can be with these softwares, rather than using something like Excel. You can go ahead and export it to Excel or export it to a PDF. But essentially, we've now got all our unknown concentrations. It even tells you the standard deviations for each of the reads. And so that's how you determine the unknown concentrations in your sample, whether it's a protein determination or whether it's a particular hormone or assay that you're doing, ELISA that you're doing, and you need to work out what the unknown concentrations are. So now you can go ahead and plot it in Excel to see the concentrations that you've obtained and beautify your graph, as I've shown in the other video, if you want to refer to it. So I'm going to leave it here. I'll catch you in the next video. God bless. Bye.